600,000 people go missing in the United States each year. Tens of thousands remain mysteriously missing.
Hi, you guys. Welcome back to Mysteriously Missing. I'm Justine.
I'm Karen. Hello, everyone. Today, we have two updates on our missing. Unfortunately, both of these have ended in a homicide, and we are offering our deepest condolences and sincere sympathy to the family and friends of both of these missing people that were now found.
Yeah, the first one we want to update you guys is with Nancy Woodrum. She was actually our first case that we did, and the San Luis Obispo County Sheriff's Office confirmed that a body was found on December 18th, 2018, believed to be 62-year-old Paso Robles resident Nancy Woodrum, who had disappeared without a trace in May 2018.
And now they have said that it is absolutely her.
Yes. Right, they have. Mm-hmm. They did arrest a suspect in the case, and I believe they're going through trial and everything, but they did confirm that they found her body.
That is correct. And I guess the suspect had done some painting at the Airbnb. And so through evidence, forensic science, they were able to track him. And he actually led them to the body out in a remote area on Highway 58 where he had left the body. And so again, to the family of Nancy Woodrum, we offer our deepest condolences and are very, very sorry for their loss. The next case is Jerome Ezell, and he also was found. His remains, skeletal remains, were found in West Michigan, and they have been positively identified as him. They're treating his death as a homicide, and he is our case that went missing in November of 2017. And if you remember that case, he had driven his car into a little wooded area in a neighborhood rather near where they lived, and the baby was found in the back alive. So thank goodness that whoever conducted this crime had enough compassion or sense to leave the baby, and then the baby was found, they're thinking, like 7 hours later, alive, a little dehydrated, but fine. So, and he leaves behind, they're reporting, 7 children. So another, we offer our deepest condolences.
Very sad, yeah. Mm-hmm. We do just want to add, if you have, you know, any information that we missed out on in our episodes or
maybe,
you know,
inaccurate.
If there's anything wrong that we maybe stated, we don't make up our information. We get everything offline and from news articles. But if there's anything that is inaccurate, you can always email us at mysteriouslymissing411@gmail.com.
Right. Sometimes, you know, we do get information that is inaccurate online, and we're more than happy to correct that. So
right. And we always do our best to do our research beforehand and, you know, get family members right and everything. But
honor the family and friends of these missing people.
Exactly. Yes. Okay, so now for today's case, we are actually talking about two people who disappeared. Her first name is Kristie, and then we also have Henry, and they both have the same last name, Wilson, but they are not married. And it's a couple who vanished from a town 80 miles east of Nashville, Tennessee on Wednesday, May 9th, 2018, and their family fears the worst, which this is about 7-8 months ago, so it's still pretty new.
Right, and they lived in a town called Cookeville, Tennessee. And they had an apartment off of Spring Street. And Cookeville is in Putnam County. And the population at the 2010 census was about 30,000. And it is home to Tennessee Technological University.
And the car that they were driving when they disappeared is a 2001 charcoal gray Nissan Sentra with a Tennessee tag number 310DVD. The vehicle had rear bumper damage and very bad tires, and the vehicle also had a lot of sun damage.
Yeah, and we'll talk about the car later. We have something to report on that.
Yeah, so Kristie and Henry have dated now for about 10 years. Like I stated, they have the same last name, but they're not married. They are described as boyfriend and girlfriend, and their relationship has been a bit rocky, but nothing points out to any foul play amongst each other, said Kimberly Redeker, which is Kristie's sister.
Right.
And there's also another quote that says, "I think wherever they are together."
Right, so she's indicating that they're not missing because they did something to each other, that there's something else going on here.
Now, Kristie Wilson, she was 39 years old when she went missing. Her birthday is November 8th, so she'd now be 40. Her height is about 5'2 to 5'5, and she weighs about 185 to 195 pounds. She's Caucasian with strawberry blonde hair and blue eyes, and she wears, she actually had a brace on her right leg, and she also had a tattoo on her leg of a waterfall and a dream catcher, and then she wears brown square-shaped glasses.
And Henry is described as 45 years old when he went missing, and he also has had a birthday since they went missing this year in May. And his birthday was November 19th. That makes him 46 years today. His daughter said that he's a great dad and she needs him back. He's described as a Caucasian male, 5'9", 160 pounds. His hair is described as bald or balding, and he mostly wears a ball cap. And his eyes are blue, and I guess previously it was listed that they were brown on some of the posters, but actually his eyes are blue. His daughter did report that he has tattoos on both arms, and on the right arm is a feather, and the left arm, we don't have a report of that.
Now, family members, Kristie does have a sister, Kimberly Redeker.
Yeah, and these are the people that we're seeing come up, you know, on Facebook and things where they're doing most of the information.
And updates
and everything.
Distributions,
mm-hmm. Yeah, for the family. So, and then there's Cheyenne Wilson, who's Henry's daughter, and then a cousin, Bridget Murphy.
Now, Kristie is on disability, but was close to returning to her job. And then Henry was a day laborer with, he did have some drug problems.
Reportedly.
So now getting into the timeline, May 9th, 2018, Henry Wilson and Kristie Wilson were last seen at Kristie's aunt's home in Monterey. There's a quote from her sister, Kimberly, that says, "Henry picked her up from my aunt's house around 8 p.m. May 9th.
So at night.
Mm-hmm. No one has seen or heard from them since. And I just feel like two people with the vehicle don't just vanish without someone noticing. The last sighting of the two was at this gas station, which was the BP station in Monterey, and this was about 12 miles from their apartment.
So it's like they were heading home.
Right. They were driving, you know, the dark gray Nissan that we talked about, and I guess he had bought maybe cigarettes while he was there. I just want to add, we kind of did a little bit of research on Facebook. There's quite a few different Facebook pages, but someone did comment that there was another male in the vehicle with them. So three people total.
Right. They couldn't identify.
Right.
So that's a little interesting.
Yeah. Like, who is this guy? Mm-hmm. The family wasted no time filing a missing persons report through Monterey police and spreading the word online.
Which we've seen all those Facebook sites.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And then an investigation soon followed.
So the Monterey police found that one of the couple's cell phones pinged off a cell tower off of Highway 85. And specifically, this is a heavy wooded area. It's over in the Allred Crawford area, and that's in Overton County. And right next to that is Fentress County. And a ping also went off in the Wilder area. So right, two counties adjoining each other. The area where the cell pings originated, as I said, is pretty remote. The morning after they went missing, Henry's phone pinged and Kristie's phone pinged in two different counties near Coy Phillips Road. Now, Kimberly Redeker, Kristie's sister, says their phones did not ping together, so that puts more worry in our heart that there has been foul play. So that's very confusing.
It's a little odd, yeah. And they were driving together and then now they're separated.
Their phones are pinging separately, mm-hmm. right.
There is a quote by Lieutenant Michael Phillips. He said, additional attempts to ping the cell phones were unsuccessful, meaning the phones have probably lost battery power.
Yeah, and family and friends spent a lot of time in getting search parties together in Putnam County, which is where they live. Their apartment's in Cookeville, and the BP station is also located in Putnam County. They went on back roads hoping to spot the two, thinking, you know, maybe their phones pinged in another county, but now they're back in the area. And they spent much of their time scouring fields and roadside ditches around the county, and I guess police joined them as well. And a cousin, Bridget Murphy, is reported as saying, places in this area that I never knew existed, places that only horses and four-wheelers can get to. It's disheartening when we're searching to know we've looked as hard as we can look and can't find anything.
Yeah, there's another quote by that Lieutenant Michael Phillips. He says, the trail has basically just stopped. We are concerned for their well-being. We are concerned about them being out here and possibly injured without the basic amenities.
Right, and she's got a brace on her leg, so it's not a good situation.
Right, so now it's September 29th, 2018, so 5 months later. It's Sunday morning, and a vehicle belonging to Kristie and Henry was found in Fentress County, about 20 miles from Tom's Market, which is where they were last seen.
Buying the cigarettes.
Mm-hmm. And the vehicle was found in Wilder on Saturday, and this is the opposite direction of their apartment.
Right, and sources close to the investigation, it said that the vehicle was found at least 200 feet off of the road, in an area called Insurance Hill. So the TBI continues, Tennessee Bureau of Investigation continues to look for the couple, and they did confirm the cell phones belonging to the couple did ping in those two counties, as we discussed, in May when they went missing, and also where their vehicle was recovered. So interesting, the pings were going off in that area the last, and then it took 5 months to find the car in that area. And it is very woodsy.
Right.
And there's a lot of heavy terrain. And so that's a possibility. Also, there was a photograph of an insurance curve by Insurance Hill, I imagine, and a lot of discarded cars in that area. So maybe it was very hard to see 200 feet off the road. And then all of the junk cars, you know, that could be reportedly put in that area. So, but Wilder, where the car was located, is in the Cumberland Mountains. And it's about 30 miles from their Cookeville home in Tennessee. And that area in Wilder is very small. In 1924... it had a population of about 2,000 as it began to be a coal mining town. And then it reached about 10,000 people. But over the years, it declined. And now it has an estimated population of only 250 people. So not a lot of people in the area where their car was found.
Mm-hmm.
So, somebody spotting them at that particular night, if that's when that occurred, or was the car put there later, since it was found 5 months later.
Yeah, that's a long time to not find a vehicle.
Right. But if it was 200 feet off the road, that may be why.
Right, yeah.
Or somebody placed it there later. Mm-hmm. So now the weather that day was 80 degrees, 40 at night. So visibility was good and there was no rain. So, you know, it doesn't seem like they probably drove off the road, but the car was, well, they didn't drive off the road because their bodies weren't found, so. Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, I mean, they've never disappeared before, so obviously their families are worried sick. The families say neither member has ever gone more than 2 days without contacting a family member.
Yeah, so it's very, very close to their family.
Yeah.
And keep in touch.
Right. There is a quote by Christie's sister. It says, if you, Kristie, can see this, if you are in a situation where you feel you need to hide, please know we have resources. We love you and are searching for you.
Yeah, and the cousin, cousin Bridget Murphy confirms that too. Kristie, if you're watching, we love you. We miss you. The babies miss you. please help us, help Henry's family, help find and closure, help them bring her home. So, you know, it's really interesting to me that they ended up in the area where the car did, where it ended up in Wilder. And they have been reported to hang out in an area called Hanging Limb. And that's off of Highway 164, which is a way you take to the Wilder area. And but it's not in the direction of their apartment. It's the opposite way. So,
which is where they were headed.
Yeah, they were supposedly headed home at 8 at night, but they ended up going the opposite mm-hmm. way. But they have hung out in an area off of 164 before, it's reported. So, you know, were they meeting someone at the gas station? That unknown male entered the vehicle.
That comment right there, and we don't know if that's true or not. It was just something we saw on Facebook. But if there was an unknown person in that car, who was that? I mean,
where's the video surveillance camera? Yeah. Was there any? And it reportedly maybe there was some drug activity.
Yeah.
And so did he get, you know, somebody in the car?
Were they doing a drug deal?
And
yeah.
And then, you know, they headed out on 164 a little bit out of town, and then things didn't go well. And 5 months later, the car's found.
Yeah, the phone's pinging in different areas, though.
That bothers me.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
It's almost like they were separated.
They were separated. And yeah, if it's one person trying to take over two people, what happens? And the family is feeling like it's foul play. Mm-hmm. It's just a mystery as to what exactly occurred. And unfortunately, where the car is found, it's a large wilderness area. And, you know, how much of searching can you do in that area? That's going to be pretty tough. So,
and I mean, if they did start walking somewhere, I mean, you can get lost out in those woods. And
right. And it is a small area. We said not much of a population. Mm-hmm. So maybe nobody saw anything that night.
Right.
But,
yeah, there's a quote I wanted to add from Cheyenne Wilson, which is Henry's daughter. She said, "I just hope if someone out there knows something, they will just come forward, because this is heartbreaking for all of us."
Right. And the family said what they need is a big police search, like the one they had in Dixon County looking for Joe Clyde Daniels. That was a 5-year-old who went missing in April. And the family thinks that that hasn't happened because these are middle-aged people with no status in the community. And, you know, as we do these cases, it varies with every police department.
It does. Mm-hmm.
Whether they get, how involved they get, what they, you know, say is a person voluntarily missing. Mm-hmm. Once they do that, then there's not a huge search on. And also, you know, is it a high profile case, and what makes it that, you know, so is it status in the community?
But you would think with two people missing,
it's unusual. You do hear couples go missing, but this is very strange.
Right. Yeah. And then Bridget, which is the cousin, said, "I just feel like a lot of tips are drug related, and the fact that they are not perfect pillars of the community has affected how police view their disappearance."
So again, the inequity, perhaps.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. They could be doing a lot more than what they are doing. These are two people we miss, and we want them back.
So anyone researching this, or if you have any information, there are several Facebook pages. One is Help Find Kristie Wilson and Henry Wilson. Another one is Missing Hearts. Another one is Tennessee Missing and Unfound. And there is a $5,000 reward for information leading to the location of Kristie and Henry.
And if you do have any information, you can also contact the Monterey Police Department. And their phone number is 931-839-2323.
You can also contact us at mysteriouslymissing411@gmail.com.
And look at our YouTube page, Mysteriously Missing, and our Instagram, which is also Mysteriously Missing. We'll have pictures up there like we always do. But again, just share and get these pictures out there. There's not a lot of pictures of them either, so it's kind of difficult. But
enough that you can see what they look like. Mm-hmm. And let's bring this couple home to their family and friends who are deeply missing them.
Thank you guys so much for listening.
Thank you.
Please like, share, subscribe to this podcast so that others can bring more awareness to this case and help family and friends bring their loved ones home.